Hi and welcome everyone to another expert talk session on MoneyFi. Here we talk to industry experts on various aspects of personal finance. And I am Gaurav from the MoneyFi team. And today we have Mr. Deepak Jain as our guest to talk about a topic. And the topic for today's discussion is how to invest globally through the mutual fund route. Deepak is the head of retail and institutional business at Edelweiss Mutual Fund, and he has over 17 years of experience into the financial services. Before Edelweiss, he was the head of retail sales at DSP Mutual Fund, and he had a long stint of 12 years at DSP. By profession, Deepak is a chartered accountant. So welcome, Deepak, for this session. We will straight away come to the topic for today's session, that is, how to invest globally through the mutual fund route. And to start off this session, I would invite you to talk on this topic, and then we'll have, some Q&A. And I would also request our viewers to put their questions in the chat window, and we'll try and take it up at the end of the session, some of those questions.
Thanks a lot, Gaurav, for having me here. It's really exciting to be talking to your clients and talking about something which is very very much in focus since last 12 to 18 months or so, and has become even more interesting in after the pandemic, investing globally and trying and benefiting from exposure globally. Now, you mentioned a very important point, investing globally through mutual funds. So there could be multiple ways of investing globally. One, you could perhaps take your money abroad and invest, or you can participate like you do in domestic investments, whether it's equity or debt, through mutual fund route. These mutual funds can in turn either directly buy stocks globally, or they can buy another mutual funds which are managed by local experts. There, people who know about the companies, people who know about the businesses, geographies, or a particular theme that may be covered. In India, the environment has been such that most people have chosen the route of investing in global funds, picking up a particular global fund, or in some cases, multiple funds, and then, investing and monitoring that investment. So I'll talk about that opportunity today. And try and take as many questions after that. What I'll do is that I'll give you a brief context of why one should be investing globally. A couple of ideas that are available at Edelweiss table, and then we'll open up for as many discussion or as long a discussion as you may want. Allow me to share my screen.
Sure.
Gaurav, please let me know if the screen is visible.
Yeah, it is visible.
Yeah. So let's start with a very simple thing of saying how does an investment works in a global fund, which invests basically in global funds. A fund based out of India, which invests in global funds. So what do you do is that first of all, you select a fund which is available internationally, a fund that you would like to be seen, experienced by Indian domestic investors. And that fund is then chosen as your fund, which will be feeded into your domestic fund. So India mein hum ek fund launch karte hain, XYZ fund. Uske andar mein jo fund hota hai, wo bahar mein kahin pe invest kar raha hota hai. So like you invest in your domestic equity mutual fund or domestic debt fund, you can invest in an international fund. It's as simple as that. So nothing extra that needs to be done from your end. There are certain other operational aspects which we will cover later during the show. So let me start with why invest in offshore funds at all. I mean, zarurat kya hai humko invest karne ki globally when there are so many opportunities to invest in India. That is something which we call as home bias. People who are staying in a particular locality wants to stay there. People who are working in a particular locality wants to work there. people who invest in a particular geography or a particular country wants to invest there. This comes because of the fact that we are familiar with the terrain, we are familiar with the news flow, we are familiar with the idea of that particular geography or a country. And this is aided by news flows. We keep on hearing more and more about those things. And we don't know much about anything outside of that particular realm of geography or idea. So this home bias is not just prevalent in India, it's globally, but in India, it is the most strong, where less than 1% of your equity investment, people invest globally. I mean, if you look at UK, for example, a UK investor typically moves around 30 to 40% of its investment globally. US investors invest globally, Japanese investors invest globally. And there are a lot of benefits of investing globally. One such benefit is access. So today, if you look around, the idea of investing is to participate in the growth of a business. If agar kuch sales ho rahi hai, kuch saman bik raha hai, kuch idea bik rahi hai, and the growth is happening, the companies are benefiting from that business opportunity. As an equity investor, you want to participate, or maybe as a debt investor, you want to lend to a company which is doing well if there is a need for money. But if you look around, the kind of things that are selling around us, for example, let's take a very simple example of automobile. Apart from Maruti, which is also a foreign collaboration, but a Maruti, which has a 40% market share, the rest 60% or almost 50% does not get captured in India. If you talk about the high-end luxury vehicles, whether it's Mercedes, Audis of the world, even Hyundai, for example, is not listed in India. Then you look at electronics, which is a very high-end consumer, highly consumed item, whether it's refrigerator, television, mobile phones. Mobile phones that we use are not manufactured, or actually you cannot benefit because the companies are not listed in India, whether it's Samsung, Apple, so on and so forth. I can just go on and on and on, and will not be able to pinpoint only 3 or 4 opportunities which we are missing. It's actually a whole lot of opportunities. The medium through which we are talking, for example, you are on YouTube Live, I'm using Zoom, I'm using a Dell computer, I'm using an operating system which is off Windows. None of these are listed in India. So there's a large opportunity where people are using, companies are benefiting. And if you also look at the market cap, global market cap is, if it is 100, India represents only 1 rupee of that. So the 99% of businesses or global market caps are available globally. So it's important that we try and capture this opportunity. And, I have given you a few examples. The slide talks about the Apples and Cokes of the world, but it's actually very all pervasive. In every sector, you would find many such opportunities which are not available in India. And hence, we need to look beyond the shores for if you want to access those world's best companies. The second, and I would like to spend some time on this slide. It's a very important slide. If you look at this slide, so what we have done here is that we have tried and captured returns of each and every major countries from a market perspective, equity market perspective, from 2009 till 2019, and see how are the returns plotted in terms of ranking them 1 to X. And also look at what has been their volatility. So if you look at, for example, 2011, US did the best when India was down by 37%, the US market was up 2%. If you look at again, 2018, US was down 4%, China was down 28%. Again, if you look at 2014, China was up 52%, and various other markets didn't do that well. So it's the idea that we are trying to project here and try to put forward here is that markets behave differently, like stocks do, like companies do, like many businesses do. So it's not that if you are participating in X market or X geography, a similar experience is going to be available in other markets. So it's important to be alive to that opportunity where A, if your domestic market is not doing well, which has been the case in many such instances, can you benefit by investing globally? And we'll talk about it, and we'll, during the presentation, I'll show you some more data around the same. Again, if you look at volatility, if you look at last 10 years of returns annualized, US has been the best performing market with a 13.6% returns and a volatility of only 12%. Compared to that, if you look at India, for example, it has shown a very high level of volatility of 21%, whereas it has been second to the bottom in terms of returns over last decade or so. And these are returns are you know, calculated by MSCI. So we're talking about MSCI returns and not necessarily Nifty or Sensex returns. But the trends are similar in nature. So this is a very, very important point to make, that like you diversify your stocks, like you diversify your other investments, it's important to look at various geographies and various countries to invest in and benefit from the same. The third point, that I wanted to make, that a country like India, which is carrying a large fiscal deficit and has a high degree of inflation, is also a country where the currency depreciates on a regular basis. If you look at last 10, 15, 20, 30 years, in fact, on an average, in last 50 odd years, we have data since 1973, Indian currency has depreciated at the rate of 4.2%. So instead of domestic currency, if your investment was in just dollar, just being in dollar would have given you 4.2% compounded annualized for last 47 years, plus the return of the asset class that you choose. So if you chose fixed income and if you got 4% there, your returns would be compounded 4.2 plus 4%. And if you chose equity as a global instrument, and let's say that return was 10%, then you can compound 10 plus 4. And then the combined compounding effect is even larger, as I will show you in the next slide. So if you look at, last many years of 12 years of returns. So for example, S&P 500 has delivered 8.8% returns in the last 12 odd years. But if I add US dollar appreciation, which basically means rupee depreciation, the returns is 13.6%. Nifty has done 10.5%. But if I were to blend this, so let's say you have a domestic portfolio which is represented by Nifty or some other stocks which are part of the Nifty or the broader markets, and do a 20% blend with US market, for instance, my returns can be enhanced by 1.4%. From 10.5 in the last 12 years, it can go up to 11.9%. If the portfolio blend was to be made 60-40, this returns can actually become 13%. So it's evident that by mixing global equities, we benefit from diversification. We also benefit from rupee depreciation, which has been the case for the last 40-45 years that we have seen. So again, three important points to note. One is that access. We have a lot of businesses which are doing well globally. Some of those businesses we are directly in touch with by being a consumer of those businesses. And technology has opened barriers like never before. We use Zoom, we use Teams, we use Prime, we use Netflix, so on and so forth. And these are the businesses which have done phenomenally well in last 10, 12, 15 odd years. So it's important that we are able to participate in their journey as investors as well. And that can be achieved if we open our minds to investing globally. The risk and reward of offshore investing are similar to domestic investment. So geopolitical risk, company specific risk, business risk. To add to that, there is one more thing. The thing that actually helps you make more money can actually also reduce your return. So for example, if rupee were to appreciate against dollar, and that has not happened on a sustained basis in last 40, 45 years, only intermittently these things happen. But if rupee were to appreciate, yes, that could cause a dent in your returns, but then you have to take a call based on a larger set of data than only concern, which is more theoretical in nature than proven data set. But that risk is very important to consider before you invest globally. So what I'm going to do now is that I'm going to talk about some of our international offerings that we offer. We have a partnership with JP Morgan Investments. JP Morgan was an AMC which was doing business in India till about 2016. Edelweiss AMC bought over the schemes of JP Morgan in 2016, December. And since then, we have been offering these products as a continuation of what JP Morgan was doing. So many of the funds that I will talk about, you may be aware of it, you may have invested now or in previous years as well. But one thing that I wanted to talk about is that through these funds, we can actually provide you access to 85%, almost 85% of global equities. So we offer currently six schemes. There is a US value fund, a recently launched US technology fund. I'm going to talk in brief about that fund. We also offer an ASEAN fund, fund invest in, as the name suggests, in ASEAN countries, a greater China fund, a China plus fund. It takes into account Hong Kong, Taiwan, and the non-mainland China, as it is called. We also offer a fund which is called Europe Dynamic Fund, basically offering access to company based out of Eurozone. And we also have a emerging market opportunities fund. All of these funds have their different dimensions and interesting investment objective. We can talk about in detail about each of these funds. But today I'll restrict my talk to overall investment, global investment, rather than only talking about all my schemes. But what I'll do is that take this opportunity to talk about a couple of our schemes, which have some investor interest. We have seen investor interest in last 6 to 9 months. And there is a strong reason for people to at least consider investment into these two offerings. So first and foremost, let me talk about Greater China Fund. And we have to take political aspects out of this conversation. I'm only referring my conversation with regard to the economic opportunity that is available, and we'll keep any other conversation out of this discussion. So this Greater China Fund, what does it do? It invests in primarily in China, but also invest in countries like Taiwan, Hong Kong, etc. And that's why it's called the Greater China Equity Fund. But in order to understand China, we need to compare it with India. I mean, in India, we do like to compare ourselves with China, but it's interesting from an investor perspective also. So let's look at the history of India and China in last 25 odd years. If any one of you have been to China or have the opportunity to read about or research on the internet, so on and so forth, you would know that China has built great infrastructure. You pass through its towns, you would know that these are one of the best constructed, well-built. The infrastructure is of high quality. The bullet trains are compared with the best in the world. Even the rural infrastructure is very, very strong. So China spent a lot of its resources, time, and energy in building high quality infrastructure. On the other hand, if you look at India, for instance, last 25 years, we've had our share of growth. We have done reasonably well as far as GDP is concerned. But if you really talk about, infrastructure of Indian cities, let's say for even the top cities, I stay in Bombay, and believe you me, if you're not from Bombay, it is not a pretty sight when you move around the city and see the kind of opportunity or gap that is still there as far as infrastructure building is concerned in Indian cities. But what we did very well was focus on having very good companies in the private sector, which offered a great opportunity to investors. In China, for instance, while they focused a large amount of their resources and time and money in building infrastructure, but those infrastructure were built by companies which were in the public sector domain. So they provided a great experience to the citizen, but not necessarily a great experience to the shareholder. On the other hand, in India in the last 25 years have built a very, very strong and vibrant private sector. Companies like HDFC, Tata, Birlas of the world have provided fantastic return on capital, return on equity to its investors by investing in solid businesses and growing those businesses over a period of time. So on one hand, Indian domestic equity and foreign investor really benefited from investing in India. But in China, though the infrastructure was built greatly, but the offering in terms of equity was primarily restricted to PSU companies, and where return on equity was not the main driving force. Because you don't invest in economies, you invest in companies after all. So it's important to be able to benefit from the growth of the companies, if there is any. But what has happened recently, and that's an important change to notice, is that China has also opened up its private sector. So in China, you can invest in two class of shares. One is called H shares, which are basically PSU companies. And the other is A class, A share class, which is private sector company. These are listed in the Shenzhen stock market, whereas the H share class were listed in the Hong Kong Stock Exchange. In last, some time, almost four or five quarters, China has opened up the A share class to foreign portfolio investors, and there have been a great interest from portfolio investors to look at private sector companies in India, in China. So China has been able to build what India was doing in the last 25 years. So China has also been now trying to build that is the robust private sector. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about it. So what are the kind of private sector investment opportunities that are available in China? So I've covered this part, that Chinese economy was and infra was better, but the private sector opportunities were very, very limited. Now that has been opened, that is driving global investor interest. What are the kinds of things that are available in China from an investment point of view? Technology and innovation. We have heard a lot about Alibaba, Tencent, and so on and so forth. There's a company called Venus Tech, which really excels in cybersecurity business. China today is the world's biggest retail market. With all this GDP growth in the last 25, 40 years, China is officially the second largest economy in the world. With all this GDP growth that has happened, the consumption power of an average Chinese citizen is also gone up significantly higher than what it was 10, 25 years ago, and much, much significantly higher than rest of the Asian peers, including India. So that is driving a lot of companies to grow business in China. If you look at even global peers, whether it's a giant automobile company, whether it's a Tesla or a tech company, whether it's Apple or so on and so forth, all of them wants to be open up shop in China for them to be able to sell their goods. But Chinese domestic companies are also becoming bigger and bigger. Their banks are one of the largest in the world. But for reasons of transparency, etc., this fund is underweight on those things, but is extremely focused on technology and innovation companies, extremely focused on healthcare companies, extremely focused on consumption companies. So five reasons to invest in Greater China. First, to start recovering after COVID-19 outbreak. Whether we believe it or not, but economically it's proven the Chinese economy have had the least amount of damage compared to the global damage. There are multiple data which are floating around. Yesterday only I heard that because of pandemic, global economy will get hit by $12 trillion. That's a huge amount, very, very huge amount. I am no expert on that, but I'm just referring to what has been quoted by some of the news articles. MSCI has boosted the weightage of Chinese A shares in its emerging market index. As I was talking about the A shares, so MSCI, which is a lot of international investors follow what MSCI does in its indices, as they follow, track those indices, that weight of Chinese A-class shares have been increased. So that will have an impact. China's economy gets wealthier, government focus increases on the sustainability of that growth. So government will do everything possible to ensure that growth is sustained. It's a most populous nation with the growing middle class And I mentioned again, it's one of the largest, it is the largest retail market in the world. So these are the reasons why one can look at investing in China. Let me just show you some of the statistics on China Fund, and you will be quite amazed to know. So if you look at what we have done is that we have plotted performances of all our funds that are available at the platform. And if you look at China Fund, for example, in last 10 years has delivered 14% compared to Nifty of 8%. And perhaps we didn't even, thought about looking at that as an opportunity. In last 1 year itself, the fund is up 52%. Not that it can continue to grow at this pace, but given the fact that it is the world's second largest economy, it is an economy which is offering the world's biggest market. It has done very well in building its infrastructure. Now it's focusing a large amount of its effort on consumption. So it was an investment-led economy. Now it's focusing on consumption. I think from a business point of view, from an investing point of view, it makes a lot of sense to look at China. One more fund and then I'll be done. So in February of this year, in January rather of this year, we looked at JP Morgan's technology fund. This is a fund which has been in existence since 1997. And sometime in 2008, it changed its color. Earlier, it was a pure play technology fund, basic technology, internet oriented companies. In 2008, it changed its track and became a fund which try and tracks companies which are disruptive in nature, which are causing disruption at a large scale and for a market which is reasonably large for us to capture. So what are the areas of some of this disruption? Cloud computing, digital transformation, electronic payment has changed the way we transact, over the top screening, 5G is something which is really big, autonomous car, machine learning, artificial intelligence, so on and so forth. This this slide is very, very important for people to understand what exactly JP Morgan does. So JP Morgan tries to identify companies at a very early stage, because if you go in too early, some of these ideas, some of these innovations may take a lot of time to fructify. So early adoption stage, not pre-adoption stage, an early adoption stage is something that they like to look at businesses and technologies. And they also want to invest in technologies which has a large addressable market and where there is a sustained competitive advantage. So what are the things that they find which are not at pre-adoption or very, very early adoption, and also which have not been a matured kind of an idea? So for example, tablets, smartphone, PCs, etc. Most of us use it. So it's not really early or disruptive technology. What is disruptive today is 5G, OTT, cloud computing, so on and so forth. So this fund basically tries and capture some of these ideas and also has a strong exit strategy. So when it nears maturity or when it nears a major adoption, then they like to exit and look for newer opportunities. The fund is up almost 78% since we launched in February. But that again should not be the reason for anyone to invest in. But look at the opportunity that it presents. Look at the sector that it represents. Today, when we talk about technology, it's actually not limited to IT. Technology is today the backbone of everything that we do. Just imagine when you order a pizza or any meal from Zomato, are you catering to a food business or you are also catering to a technology business? Same thing, same line of thinking goes for Uber, and so on and so forth. So technology today is all pervasive, whether it's retail, healthcare, other parts of the businesses, all of them use technology to either increase their output, increase their efficiency, or to reduce costs and make it more profitable. So technology is the backbone of business growth and is going to be a driving force behind a growth of businesses across the globe. So with this, Gaurav, I would like to take a pause and perhaps we can take as many questions as you may want me to take.
Yeah, thanks, Deepak. I think you shared a very good overview of the entire international investing space, and you covered three very, very critical and very right points. The reasons why anybody should look at offshore funds, whether it is access to the companies which are not available, whether it is diversification benefits, and hedge against the depreciating currency also. So all these are three very relevant points. So while we covered the overview, there are a few questions which might be there in the minds of a lot of our viewers. And now we can dwell a little deeper into about international funds. And the first question that comes to my mind, or to anybody who is trying to look at international investments, is how do we categorize international funds? So whether it is developed economies, developing. So how would you categorize it in terms of the funds?
A very important and relevant question. Let me start with a basic, and then I'll talk about what is available in India. Like we have in India, we have our pure equity fund, then we have income funds, and we have hybrid funds. Globally also, these kind of funds are available. In fact, much of our learning comes from our global experiences. But since we're talking about funds that are available in India today, for Indian investors to invest globally, I would broadly classify those funds into two areas. One area is geographical access. So basically funds which offers you some kind of a geography. So for example, a US fund, it's offering you an opportunity to invest in US markets. I mentioned about China fund. So a fund which offers you access to Chinese market. Geography in terms of, group of countries, for example, emerging market economies. For example, ASEAN economies, I mentioned, Latin American countries. So either one single specific country or a group of companies, or you can also have global funds which invest, as per their own matrix across the world. So there are, 2-3 funds which are available in India, which offers you opportunity to invest in, around the globe. The only thing with the pure play global fund is that the returns are very muted from an Indian investor's point of view. And hence you may want to rotate your investment between geographies and themes and perhaps try and benefit. The second category of funds are theme-based. I mentioned earlier. So whether it's thematic in sense, let's say it's catering to commodities, it's catering to mining companies. I spoke about technology fund, for example, US technology. So it's catering to disruptive global technology. Okay. It could be a healthcare, global healthcare fund, because a lot of things domestically are available as far as healthcare is concerned, but innovation, research. So if you see, for example, the vaccine research is happening globally, but the manufacturing capability is in India. So it's a great, mix of, so we also have a fund which is called Edelweiss MSCI Healthcare Index. So it's a combination of domestic versus, global fund. So these are the two broad themes, classification. One is geography-based classification, and the other is theme-based classification. So depending upon outlook on each of these, so for example, if you have a great outlook on emerging market, one can look at emerging market. One, if you think that US has done pretty well in last 10 years and is nearing topping out, perhaps one can reduce exposure from US and, increase exposure to emerging markets. People have been talking about that in general.
Okay. Now, the other, question that comes to everybody's mind is, what is the allocation I should make to a international fund or a bouquet of international funds? And I know it's not a very straightforward, solution, but what is it that you feel and, an average Indian investor should have allocation to internationally?
So one is an ideal answer, and the other is a practical answer. The ideal answer is that you should look at all funds without branding them, whether they are, global or domestic. I have seen some large family offices actually benefit a lot by investing globally. But if I were to ask people who have never invested globally to invest 40-50%, I think that will be a stretch. So I think one can start with 5-10% exposure and perhaps can take it up to 20-30 at certain point in time. Because only 1% of businesses are represented in India. I mean, think of it, 99% of global market cap is not India. Though it's a great economy to invest in, it has great potential to grow further. But at the same time, we live in present also. We are building for the future, but we live in present also. So maybe your customers can start at 5-10% and then see from their experiences. One thing I would like to mention is that generally, and this has been my experience while, you know, I was also working with DSP, and there also we had some fantastic international ideas. People generally come at the peak of some of these ideas when returns have actually come and they're only chasing returns. I think that should not be the only criteria. That can be one of the criteria, but it has to be a, first of all, long-term in nature, and then a diversification, you know, theory that you apply to it, and not only returns. I hope this answers your question.
So, while selecting international funds, you know, for anyone to look at, what are one or two important factors that one should look at? Is it the AMC? Is it any other factor that, you know, which we should look for? Maybe one or two important ones.
So one thing which global investors look for is quality of team and the tenure the team has stayed managing the fund, which is very important. So if you, in fact, they will highlight in their presentation that this team has a collective experience of X number of years and with the fund X number of years. So it's important to look at the quality of the team, what kind of, you know, past track record that a team has delivered and how many years they have been with the firm. So most of the JP Morgan guys, if you really look at some of the funds that we talk about, have been with the firm for 10, 15, 20 years managing the same scheme. So that kind of, you know, track record with the same manpower is something very, very critical to look at. And then of course, there are other things that you look at in terms of, you know, valuations, et cetera, versus the benchmark and so on and so forth. Those are, I think, matter of detail, but broadly speaking, as you wanted me to talk about one or two scheme, I think one or two things, I think the track record of the team and the tenure is very, very important for how long they have been managing. If there has been too many chops and churns, I think that's a red flag.
Now coming to Deepak, on the taxation part, you know, I know a lot of our viewers would like to understand how does the taxation work for international funds as far as India is concerned?
So taxation is a very important question that you asked. It works like any other debt mutual fund. The tax benefit that Indian investors enjoys while investing in domestic equities is not available while investing in global equities. But the benefit of indexation is available. So for example, if you invest for, let's say, today, and for some reason were to redeem after 4 years, you will get four indexation benefits. And then whatever the income is left of that, 20% taxation will be applicable. In effect, it is still 10-12%. Today, long-term capital gains equity taxation is also 10%. So I don't think so it will be really way off from what is for domestic equity funds, anywhere between 10 to 15 post-indexation.
So taxation is simply same as the debt fund taxation. So nobody...
It's simple. Other
kind. About the complications in taxation.
No complication.
And Deepak, I assume the settlement cycles are also different for international funds in terms of...
Again, very important, you know, question from our... You know, since investors may not know this, it's very important that we put forward. While we invest in domestic equities, the fund manager gets a order of redemption. We sell the stock in T plus two. The money is available in T plus three. We transfer the funds to investors. In case of global investing, there is one more leg where you place the order globally and there are time differences, etc. So the generally accepted cycle in the industry per se is T plus five. For redemption, for everything, it's T plus.
We can
from a purchase point of view, it's the same experience.
Okay.
So VPM cutoff, the NAV is declared next day, most cases, because markets globally are operating. So in case of domestic NAVs, which are available at 11 p.m., international funds NAV mostly are available by 10:30 a.m. next day.
Okay. So we can take a few questions from our viewers, and we have got quite a few here. So one of the questions here is that is there any option to hedge the currency impact on international funds?
It's a question which has, I have been, you know, receiving these questions in the last 14 odd years. Most of these funds are not hedged. Simple reason, the cost of hedging is actually very high. I mean, if you were to look at 6 month options, the option premiums are close to 5-6%. So if you are gaining roughly 4% on an average from the currency, and if you were to hedge that completely, I mean, you are actually not making any sense, because if it were an appreciating currency, it makes sense. But from a real exchange effect, real effective exchange, RER, which is a term which we use to look at the right value of the currency, Indian currencies have always been overvalued. So how do you value a currency? You look at the interest rate of the competing currency and the inflation in the competing currency versus what you have domestically. Indian inflation and interest have always been high. For that, you have to compensate by depreciating your currency. So it's not really a viable idea. And most of the funds don't do any hedge.
So there is another interesting question that we have got is, it says, I need to save for my younger sibling MBA from US, and the goal is 10 years away. Should I consider investing in US markets?
See, it's a very right way of thinking, at least, that I have an expenditure in US and I want to capture and, invest my money in dollar in one sense, and also participate in the US market. But again, as I said previously, that US markets have seen a bull run of almost 12 years, ever since the Great Depression, GFC, Great Financial Crisis of October 2008, US markets have only seen one way. So one needs to evaluate the relative opportunities and risks of investing in US. But if the idea is to invest over the next 5 to 10 years, I think it's a good idea. But let me show you one slide, which is very, very important. US markets have a distinct feature which is not available with most markets. Can I do that?
Yeah, sure.
Is the screen visible?
Yes, it is visible now.
So if you look at this slide, the idea of diversification is to invest in either asset classes or products which are not correlated, wherein they don't move in tandem with each other. The correlation between India and US market since 1990 is 0.07, which means there is no correlation. So from a risk point of view, from a dollar hedge point of view, from a, it being the biggest economy in the world point of view, it makes sense to invest in US. But again, I would just make that caveat that valuations, etc., has to be considered. And maybe one can look at a staggered approach and also invest US++. Maybe look at more ideas ex-US, and then make a diversified portfolio rather than only investing in one country. I hope that answers that question.
Yes. Now, another question I have is, again, very interesting one, is how do we benchmark the performance of international fund? Should we remove the currency impact and then see how it has done against the benchmark, or is there any other better
way? So the data is available. All fund houses provide you underlying fund performance as well as the domestic fund performance. So basically in dollar terms as well as in INR terms. So one should look at, and I mentioned it is one of the factors you should look at while evaluating a fund. So yes, you should look at benchmark versus the fund performance. But one thing is also very, very, you know, true. Unlike India, globally, most actively managed funds, you know, don't beat their benchmark. And hence, there is a, you know, clamor of investing in passives. And hence, I made the point that you should try and pick up themes. You should try and pick up certain geographies at a certain point in time and try and do better. If you're only playing the market beta, you're only trying to gain from just what the market is doing, then perhaps ETF is a way to invest. So for example, I don't want to talk about the fund house, but there is a fund which invests in NASDAQ ETF. So that's a, you know, exposure to what the, you know, NASDAQ offers you. So those kind of things are also possible. But yes, benchmark versus fund is very important.
So Deepak, other than equity, so there is a query that other than equity, are there any other asset classes, you know, for which there are international funds available right now? I know there is a REIT, you know, NFO also going on. So are there any more or expected in future? What is your view?
Yeah, so I think there is one, you know, fund which invests in global fixed income. I haven't been able to keep pace with that fund. I think Templeton used to offer one. And you mentioned about one REIT opportunity that is, I think currently the NFO is on. I'm not really expert on that, but what one should watch out for is that some of these funds, both on debt side and on REIT, because these are yield play, right? Yield. And global yields are at their lowest, almost lowest. So you can only benefit from some of these funds if there is a leverage. So many fixed income ideas globally, in fact, mutual funds are allowed to leverage in certain geographies. So it's important to look at the underlying fund. Is it leverage? Because the unwind of leverage is really fearsome. And we have seen in 2008. So while you think that you're investing in fixed income kind of instrument, because of leverage that is there, that can actually make it even worse than equity experience. So I would exercise caution. I would exercise more prudence, more diligence before jumping into some of those ideas.
Okay. There are a few questions, Deepak, on FOF, on the fund of fund structure. And I think if we can talk a bit more, what is this fund of fund structure and how does it work? And is the underlying fund being actively managed? It's not a passive strategy.
Excellent question. Let me take an example of what we do domestically and then take that example globally. So as you are aware that we provide Bharat Bond ETFs, right? Which are available on exchange, or you can buy during the primary issuance. But many investors are not comfortable buying ETF. So we have provided them opportunity to invest in fund of fund, Bharat Bond fund of fund. So what the fund of fund does, fund of fund invests into ETF. It is the only security that the fund holds. So Bharat Bond fund of fund investing into Bharat Bond ETF. Similar kind of experience happens in international fund of fund. So for example, when I talk about Edelweiss Greater China Fund, what it does, Edelweiss Greater China Fund is investing into the underlying fund, which is JP Morgan Greater China Fund. Now, JP Morgan in turn manages the fund like we manage our equity funds here domestically, whether it's large cap, mid cap, diverse, you know, so on and so forth. So underlying fund is actively managed. I am providing you access, and these are called feeder funds. So my fund is the feeder fund. It is feeding into the international fund, which is actively managed. In fact, if you want, we can share more data. It's available on our website. Some of these funds are managed by 20-25 professionals, ranging from analysts to fund managers to CIOs. Very, very actively managed ideas. Some of the funds, as I mentioned, that NASDAQ, for example, is an ETF fund of fund. So whether it's a ETF fund of fund or an active fund of fund, that you would be able to figure out once you look at the prospectus.
So it could be either a passive underlying or it could be an active managed fund, and that's what is available.
The domestic feeder is only a vehicle to invest. It's a vehicle. You should look at it as a vehicle of investing. And I think it may not, you haven't asked this, but it's very relevant. The cost of investing is also very well regulated by the regulator. So you cannot charge either more than 2.25 or 3x of your underlying expense. So if the underlying fund is 50 paisa, you cannot charge more than 1.5. But if the underlying expense is 1%, your cap is 2.25. So SEBI has regulated it very, very well in terms of cost and other things like any other fund.
I think Deepak, we have taken up most of the questions, and I think with respect to the time, we are almost there for our webinar. So thanks a lot for this webinar. It was very, very insightful. And I thank all our viewers who have taken time out and attended this webinar. I'm sure they would also have got a very good and easy understanding of what international funds are and what are the options available. And I would also request our viewers to please download the MoneyFi app. You can start your investment journey through this app. It has a fully digital KYC process as well. And there are a lot of other products, including mutual funds on this platform. And also do subscribe to our YouTube channel for more such insights and expert talks that we keep organizing for the benefit of our viewers. So thanks, Deepak, once again
for doing this webinar.
Thanks.
Thank you so much, everyone, for having me here. Thank you so much.